Hey, welcome everybody to the January 10th, 2024 POS 5 podcast coming to you from Finnegans Pub 302 located at 1701 Lovering Avenue in Wilmington, Delaware for Salesianum night. We have a great show tonight with some special guests including former Salesianum and NFL great Kevin Reilly, Salesianum head football coach Gene Delle and Salesianum head basketball coach Taylor Trevisan. I'd like to take a moment to thank our host Finnegans Pub 302 and owner Paul Degners for having us tonight and providing drink specials and food. And of course, it's great to see all the Salesianum alumni, family and friends as we get ready to talk some sports. Just to let the audience, our audience know, you can follow the POS 5 on Facebook at the POS 5, on the web at thepos5.com, and listen to us on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Amazon, and YouTube.
Good evening. Thank you for coming. Our first guest is Kevin Reilly. He's got the real Eagles jersey on. Kevin's a former professional football player. He began his career at Salesianum High School. He continued his career on the main line at Villanova. Then he was drafted by the Miami Dolphins in 1973. He returned home later that year and joined the Eagles. He served as captain of the squad's special team for two seasons and ended his career with the New England Patriots. Kevin, welcome to the show. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me, guys. And, you know, I did play with the Patriots, but that was back before they started cheating. So I want everybody to know that.
Kevin, the room is, we have some what we would call Salesian gentlemen in the room tonight. So we are going to talk about some of your time at Salesianum. Your senior year, a few nights before the opening game against St. James, you did your first interview with the newspaper and made a comment along with your fellow teammate, Mike Webb. And it kind of upset your coach, Coach Allen, at the time. And can you tell us about what was the aftermath the next morning when the article ran in the newspaper?
Well, let me tell you what happened is we weren't used to being interviewed by anybody except the principal of the school, you know. And we had this guy came out to interview us, and he interviewed the coach Wayne Allen, and he was asking me what I thought about our prospects. Well, we had come off a year, our junior year, we were 8-1, and there wasn't any reason with 26 returning seniors that we didn't think we could go undefeated. And I happened to mention that was our goal. And Mike chimed in, not only are we going to go undefeated, but we're going to go unscored upon. Well, I mean, if you're talking about giving locker room information to the people that are coming down, this was a tough game, too, against St. John's. So the next day we had a rally at the in the auditorium, and they introduced all of us and introduced Coach Wayne Allen last. And he came out, and he took the mic, and he said, "These guys have no idea what they've got themselves into, and I think they're going to lose tonight." And he left the stage, and we were all standing up there.
Wow.
Mike and I felt very embarrassed about the whole situation. But, you know, Mike was the one to put it over the top. We're going to go unscored upon. It's really funny because I look back about a year and a half ago. That year, we weren't unscored upon, but we only allowed 31 points the whole season.
Wow.
So it was a pretty good defense. But we went undefeated. We ended up, you know, I think this was the beginning that year, 1969. There was a lot of talk about who was the best team in the state. Was it Newark with, you know, the three great guys they had down there, Bobby Tucker, Heyman, and what was the other guys? Pedro Swan. Those three guys have been playing together since they were in, like, second grade. And they had a really good team, and we had a really good team. And it was hard to say who was number one. They ended up undefeated, and we ended up undefeated. And I think that became our coaches, Wayne Allen, and the Newark coach were seen at each other, at our games, our final games, and there was rumors going around that was going to start to have a playoff system. And I think it took a couple years to take hold, but that was the original, why we can't have these arguments, let's have a playoffs, the top two teams, top four teams, and I think that's how it started. But it was an unbelievable year. I'm so proud of the team. 11 guys from that football team got scholarships to play football in college. Two went to Notre Dame. Two of us went to Villanova. One went to Kentucky. One went to Delaware. One went to Drexel. One was at Tufts University. One was at Dartmouth. That was Chuck Dabrowski, our quarterback, who just passed away a year ago. And I'm missing somebody, but I think there was two at Drexel. So there was 11 guys. Now, only five guys played the whole 4 years. But that's never happened at the school before or since. That's just something that,
incredible.
It was incredible. Yeah. A bunch of athletes that I played with that year.
And that's the thing, too. College wasn't a big deal. I mean, a lot of people didn't have the means to go to college.
Oh, right. I mean, our class, just, taken away from the athletics, our class had set the record for scholarships, both from the athletic side and also academic side. I know it's been top since then, but that was a really good class of people.
That season, obviously undefeated, what did it mean to you as a player and as a person?
Well, I was the lone captain. I was hoping we'd have co-captains. And when you're the lone captain, you're kind of like standing out there by yourself. And our good friend, Father Ashenbrenner, whose funeral was yesterday, passed away at 97, was our not only our chaplain, but he taped ankles. He got your uniforms ready. He drove the bus. And I can remember being on the bus with him going down there. And it was one of those things that I kind of felt isolated on an island, because it was just me as the captain. But I had him there continually talking to me and saying, look, don't be worried. Just do the right thing. And I can remember him telling me that. And we had some hard choices coming down the road. But, those things rung in my ear, and I think we did the right things, and that's why we ended up undefeated.
Yeah.
Speaking of Father Ashenbrenner, who did pass away at the age of 97 just recently in the beginning of the new year, he was the athletic director, and you did share a story with us when we interviewed you recently about the game down in Middletown.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he was a huge part of Salesianum. He was the athletic director, and, he's just an overall big part. What can you tell us a little bit about him and what he meant to you during your time at Sally's?
He was, I don't think that St. Francis de Sales himself could have emulated the Catholic faith any better than Father. This guy was humble. He worked hard. He knew what the right things were. He was always there for you. He was a tremendous guy. He also had, and no people, this is what part of him they don't understand, he had a great sense of humor. As a matter of fact, they were talking about that at his funeral yesterday. He had a buddy down there who also passed away, and they would go on at each other, just teasing each other, at the dinner table and stuff. But one funny thing is, I think it was when Charlie Michael Ajeski was quarterback, and he got dinged. He had a concussion, and they took him out of the game. They didn't even call him concussions, and they wanted to just shake out the cobwebs and go back in. And of course, Father Ash was the trainer, and so Dim turns him over to the trainer, and Father takes him back to sit him down, and he's breaking the ammonia caps under his nose, and he's not even blinking. So second string quarterback's not doing well, and Dim says, "Hey, Father Ash, come here, Father Ash, come here." So Father Ash comes here. He says, "Hey, when's Michael Ajeski going to be ready to go back in?" He says, "He can't go back in." He says, "What do you mean he can't go back in?" He says, "Coach, he's so bad he doesn't even know his name." Dim thought for a second, said, "Tell him he's Johnny Unitas and send him back in." And so that was one story. The second story was playing down at Middletown, and this was the game that meant a lot. This was the game that was the tiebreaker. The first game, I'm sorry, it was the first game down there. We didn't know what to expect. They had referees from downstate. Nobody thought too much about it. It was the second quarter. They had a 7-0 lead, and we did a bootleg with Jody Tagani, our quarterback, and we had a guard pull out, and they threw the flag, and they said, "Illegal man downfield," and they called the touchdown back. I think we ran a play to Bernie Sewell up the middle, didn't gain much, so the next one was a naked reverse to the right with Jody Tagani, no blockers. They threw the flag, and they said there was a man downfield. Yeah. Well, 27, 28-year-old Wayne Allen, who was the most competitive individual I've ever known, he throws the clipboard down and hits me in my feet. I'm standing next to him because I went on third and longs, and he's walking across. I thought he was walking out to our team, to huddle. He walks all the way across the field and is screaming at Bill Billings that you got these refs in your back pocket. And he's walking back, and he's signaling to everybody, "Get on the buses. We're going home. Get on the buses. We're going home." And all of a sudden, Ash appears out of nowhere, and he gets in front of him. And, coach is, pushing him a little bit, and he finally stops him. And I never knew what he said to him. But coach came back, picked up the clipboard and continued to coach. We got beat that night.
Wow.
But I said to, I went down to see Father last year, me and Mike Gallagher and Mike Hart, and he was in really good spirits. Nothing was wrong with his brain. I said, you got to tell me what you said to him that night. I have to know. And he said, I took the keys to the bus out of my pocket. I said, Wayne, here's the keys. You can drive home and I'll coach the team. Nobody's leaving.
That's great, sir. All right, so the big question, what are your thoughts on the Birds going to Tampa?
I think they have the perfect storm right now. I think one of the things, and I've been talking about it with the coaches here, one of the things that I think is underestimated is when you have anybody that's new in a coaching position. Not only do they have a new offensive coordinator and a new defensive coordinator, and you can think you really know a lot or you don't know a lot, but that's when you're supposed to learn, you know, that first year. And you have to get all these guys who don't know you, they've got to want to go to bat for you. So when you're 9-0, okay, and you haven't lost a game, why would you change any of your defense or offense? You wouldn't, right? You'd be afraid to. You'd be afraid to make a mistake. Well, that was a mistake because the 49ers really showed what could happen when they look at, you know, film that even a guy like McCafferty can be sitting back on a TV set and say they're going to run this play. And you can't say, okay, well, where was that second defense? Where was that second offensive sets that we were going to do that we practiced back in the double sessions? They don't have double sessions anymore, and that's one of the other problems. You can't get a lot accomplished new in 90 minutes of practice 4 days a week. And one of them's a walkthrough. You can hear the guys from the Miami Dolphins bitching about the hard practices they have. They're still going out in pads 2 days a week. They still, everybody has to abide by the 90 minutes. But they're going out there, and look at the difference. I mean, it really looked like we gave up the other day. And Brian Baldinger puts out these, I'm on the, one of the things that he sends out, and it's his observation of watching the film. And he had three plays there where our guy Davis looked like he was overweight, out of shape,
slow.
And here's a guy, now, you can't blame him totally. This is a guy who played 11 games in college and didn't really have to exert himself a lot. He's into the 17th game of the season, and that doesn't count in the exhibition games. But that's no excuse. That guy should have been, you know, replaced or run harder or whatever. And that's only one of their things. They got a lot of things, you know, going bad for them right now. Do I think they could win this week? Yeah, Tampa's not that good. And the reason I think they can win is emotional carry them. I don't think they'll, you know, have a new offense or defense put in place in time for that. They could make some adjustments, but that's about it.
Kevin, what do you think, being an old-time linebacker, I'm a linebacker also, what do you think of their lack of importance of the linebacker position?
Well, I wonder about the linebacker training they're getting. And, you know, when they blitz, there's for some reason they run into the back ass of our tackles. And, you know, when I was down in Miami, we had to, when we were going to blitz, we had to talk to the defensive linemen to see what shoulder they were going to take on the offensive guy so I'd have something to squirt through, you know, and that gave you an opportunity. Our guys are getting blocked by our own guys and leaving, you know, our defensive backs out there naked. And I don't see them filling holes, you know, correctly, and that's because the defensive line is not moving people off the ball. So if the worst part of that defense is without a doubt the linebackers. Now, it's tough now. You know, back when I was playing, you could play three downs. Bill Berge played three downs. He wouldn't play three downs today because he couldn't carry, you know, be able to, you know, get somebody coming out of the backfield or cover the slot guy. So it's a lot different. But, you know, there are good linebackers in the league, and we just don't have any of them. And I don't know how you, you know, fix that up. Leonard looks terrible. He looks like he's trying not to get hurt. And why wouldn't you come on with a team halfway through the, well, two-thirds of the way through the season? You're getting a paycheck, and they're not going to keep you next year. Why would you want to get hurt?
And we've heard that, too, with the tackling. They don't practice tackling now. I mean, you guys, that's a whole skill in itself. The tackling, even the whole NFL is poor. Do you agree with that?
Well, they don't tackle in practice. They don't tackle at all. They're afraid of getting a million-dollar athlete hurt.
Yeah, you have to. That's a learned art. You don't just become a tackler. There's a way to do it, the form and everything. We, from the legs up to the chest. And then if you don't practice it, you're not going to be that good at it.
And you know who's doing the best tackling on the team is the young guys. And you know why? Because they used to practice tackling in college. And they'll lose it eventually by not being able to practice it. But that's one of the problems, you know, throughout the league is that nobody wraps. Yeah, and these guys that go in with their shoulders just trying to knock people down. Well, you got to wrap with these guys with their backs. All right.
So we have a couple minutes. Is there anybody in the audience that would like to ask Kevin a question or two? Is anybody out here that has a question on the NFL or Kevin's career at Sally's, Kevin's career in the NFL?
I got a Villanova football question.
All right.
Do you see Villanova, Kevin, taking the step up to a D1 level like UD did, or do you think they'll stay at that CAA level for many years?
They've been talking about it for a long time. And it's on the you know, table. It's off the table. The stadium would have to be fixed up a little bit, although it's been fixed up. I really don't know. I don't know who to believe when I get the stories back because I'm not on the committee that's going to make a decision like that. But I think you got to do a lot of homework. What surprises me about Delaware does not surprise me about they wanted to move up. They could move up. They have the fan base. They got the student body. You know, they've got the facilities. You know, the thing that concerns me is their fan base now. You take a look at the schedule for next year and who's in their conference. Their closest game is Virginia, and it's a five-hour drive. These fans, I don't know how they're going to react to it because they're used to going to Villanova, to Temple, you know, driving distances to some of these places, Navy, whatever. And I also wonder about the athletes that have to go on six planes a year if you're going to play 11 games and six are away. I see it from Villanova, how it can wear these guys out. You know, big guys, they're not getting special planes for them. They're all packed on these planes, you know, and they got their headphones on. And it takes a little out of you. So the travel, you know, not having anybody close. I think the other thing is not having any natural rivals. You know, I think it hurts the emotion of the game. But it's going to be interesting. I hope we don't move unless we're really ready. Teams that didn't make it were teams like Connecticut. JMU was ready. They were ready to go. They had the backers to go. Look at it. They're in the top 25. So it can happen either way, but you better be sure you got the resources that can back you up.
Kev, I also heard, too, being from Delaware County, that the Radnor Township restricts Villanova from making the stadium any larger. Whereas Delaware can go on the sides, the end.
Yeah, they were talking about 35,000 seat minimum or something along those lines. I heard them talking about
for D1, and they remember my sophomore year they stopped tailgating.
Right,
that hurt.
Yeah, I think, and I could be wrong on this, but I think they've lowered it to 20,000, and some of the teams they did that because you're going to see the teams that are in the division in 2025 with Delaware. They're not going to have games. They're going to have games with people at 10,000, but they have to have a stadium that will hold 20.
Okay.
So, and then, you know, they're one of the reasons those guys moved up is they look to the sharing of, you know, money when anybody goes to a bowl game or whatever. That's one of the pluses to that. It'll help in their recruiting. There's no doubt about that. But I just wonder about that league, why you got in that league. It's all over the place.
Kev, thanks as always. You're always special to talk to. Yeah.
Well, thanks for having me, guys, and good luck with this program. You guys are always ready and prepared, and it's a joy coming on.
Thank you so much. With guests like you is why it goes. You know, that's the excitement. I'm telling you. You know what? I only got to meet you through this, and it's just such a blessing. You're just such a great guy.
Is that why they put you down here next to me?
Well, I keep telling everyone I know you. They're like, no, you know, we know each other.
He wants a picture.
I know. I'm like, I need a picture to show everyone. They're like, you're full of it. I'm like, no, we really know each other.
Well, thanks for having me, guys. Anytime.
Thanks, I appreciate it, brother.
Thanks, Kevin.
Thanks a lot. Guys, before we get to our next guest, I just want to do a shout out to the company and the sponsor that makes Paws run. It's, you know, you can see the shining of Mike's bald head. It's because of the guys at Shaving Grace Barbers. It's owned and operated by the Segura brothers, over 30 years in the barber industry. They have locations in Exton, Malvern, and their OG shop is in East Falls, PA. Just a great group of guys.
It's time now for our next special guest, and that is Salesianum head football coach Gene Della Donne. Gene's an 05 graduate of Salesianum High School. He was named the 2004 Gatorade Player of the Year. He was a four-year varsity letterman. Following his high school career, he was a two-year starter at Middle Tennessee State University. In 2023, he was named the 13th all-time head coach in the storied history of Salesianum football. Gene, welcome to the Pos 5.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Thank you for being here.
This is a great operation, too. Very impressive.
Thank you, Coach.
Coach, it's a great year, though, too. I'll tell you, exciting, you know, what you're doing for this school. What a great school.
Thank you.
The game we went to, actually, me and Mark, 35-0, William Penn at half.
Yeah,
that was wild. That's who we played in our championship was always William Penn.
Cool story about that. I actually went out and got past player quotes, like Troy Reader, Brian O'Neill, Andrew Zerba, a couple of those guys, to talk about what like the gold helmet means. And I read that as the pregame speech.
Awesome.
The kids, like, they love, they've responded pretty well to that. That was awesome. William Penn game. Yeah.
That's awesome. So, obviously, one of your first interviews as a head coach, you were quoted saying, "We will create a culture where excellence is expected," which is always expected at Salesianum High School. And obviously, that happened because in your first season, you won the state championship. So, what did that first season mean to you there down at Sally's?
Well, at Salesianum, it's, if you're a head coach and you don't win a state title, it's almost like you get fired. After Coach Trevisan was, you know, he won his state, there was a lot of pressure. I guess it was almost a year ago today, I attended one of the coaches' conventions. You see a lot of the off-season clinics going on, Glacier, Atlantic City. And anyway, I sat in on Nick Saban speaking. And he talked about his tagline to his players was edit your behavior. So I adapted that the day I got hired. And from day one to kind of create the new culture, if you will, we talked about editing our behavior every day, whether that be in the classroom, at home at the dinner table, on the football field, of course, or in the school. So that was something that the kids kind of took on to pretty quickly. And I thought we used that throughout the season to progress to a state title.
Awesome. So winning the first year state champs, obviously, I mean, you're obviously going to want to win again and again and again. What's your approach this year, and when do you start working out?
We have a workout tomorrow morning at 6:30 in the morning at Abyssinia Turf.
Okay, so there you go.
So we try to run it, you know, again, I'll go back to Coach Trev, but you have to run your program these days as if it's a college-type current program, right? If not, you get beat. There's a lot of high school is now the modern day college, and then college is now semi-pro with the whole NIL and stuff like that. Yeah. But anyway, so if you're not running a current college type program, there's opponents out there, especially in this local Philadelphia area, that will beat you.
Wow.
And we pride ourselves at Salesianum really across the board of running these college like programs, and they're all year round. I mean, people don't realize that we start our 2024 season tomorrow.
Right.
And obviously voluntary workouts and things like that. But,
and some guys playing on Trev's team.
They do.
Yep.
Yep. Absolutely.
Gene, I read an article in the Tennessee when I guess you were playing Middle Tennessee State. I saw the stats. I knew you were a great player, great coach. But I was real impressed with your family and the relationship you have with your older sister, Lizzie. Mm. And, of course, your younger sister is dominant as she is in women's basketball.
Yeah.
But I'm a big family guy, too. My brothers, we do everything together. I mean, what kind of strength do you draw from your older sister?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, she puts a lot of things in perspective. You're talking about, you know, an older, our sister who can't see, hear, talk, communicate, really. She'll grab our heads and just smell our heads, and that's kind of how she knows who my mom and dad are.
That's awesome.
So when you're sitting across from an individual like that, playing Middletown really isn't that important.
Right.
I mean, it's
great point.
It's bigger than football, and that's what we tell our guys as well.
But she's got your parents, I give them a tremendous amount of credit. It's two great athletes, and then caring for your older sister the way you do. I mean, I was reading the article. It was a great article, how she was on the sidelines.
Yeah.
And I noticed she recognizes sometimes by smell and touch.
Absolutely.
And the way you guys stay close to home, and I know your sister had a lot of issues going further away when she became a pro.
Mm-hmm.
I just think it's really awesome. And I think that story's got to be told a little bit more than just your accolades as a coach and everything.
Thank you. Yeah,
it's really amazing. It's a great credit to your parents.
Yeah, she's the glue. She's the energy of our family. She was my buddy when I was a senior in the Blue Gold game, which was a cool moment too.
Sure.
Great.
We joke about our family dinners are based around Lizzie. If she wants steak, we eat steak. If she wants Yonkees, we eat Yonkees. And if she wants a burger, we're going to have a burger. So she's awesome. The rock of the family.
I love it, though, too. Like you said, it puts everything in perspective. You know, that game's not that important.
It's not.
You know, and it just that's wonderful. That's really nice.
Thanks.
So, I mean, I guess I have to give a little bit of credit to my brother, Mike. I mean, he was the 1987 Gatorade Player of the Year.
There you go.
So,
real quick, though, keep in mind, they wouldn't even let Mark drink Gatorade.
Well, and I also know Mike wrote this script, so.
Yeah.
I don't have that. That's how that got in there.
That was put in there.
He's padding his stats.
So, we got, I mean, we just celebrated our alumni. It was Mike's 35th year. It was my 30th, and we go together because I graduated on a 3. He was on an 8. So, it's nice to have ours together, and we always had to walk through, and he shows me his trophy and
first thing
picture in the weight room.
Yeah,
it's starting to get old every 5 years, you know. So, but we go. But so obviously, just recently, I guess it's BJ Alaney. Do I have that correct?
Eileen.
Eileen. Yep. Okay. He was actually just named the Gatorade Player of the Year. So now that makes him the 7th student athlete of Salesianum history to win that award.
Yep.
What kind of player? I know there are some quotes from other head coaches about what kind of player he was. He was a game changer.
He was. Not many people realize, too, he started his freshman year at Salesianum. Wow. And then transferred to DMA. His brother became on the football staff there. He went over there. And then, so of course, he came back, which was a huge get for us. Lucky to have him. He carried the ball 30-plus times almost a game when we needed to, right? So he took a pounding. And the first 3 games of our season up until Dover, first 4 games, he was our leading tackler at free safety on defense, which, again, people don't realize. But we had pulled him because we needed him that much on offense.
Yeah.
He threw 3 touchdown passes. He ran 29-plus rushing touchdowns. But I'll say – but about BJ, because it's pretty cool – he's going to West Point next year for his freshman year, and the staff was in there recruiting him. And I told a story, and we showed the team this. We were playing Appomattox, game 7 of the season, and we called a halfback toss. He was a quarterback at DMA, so he could throw the ball. And we pitched it to him, and he threw the touchdown. It was like a 65-yard pass, whatever. But as our team was celebrating and the ball was all over, you see him come out of the left side of the film. He grabs the ball from the kid, from our player celebrating, and he runs it right to the ref. Wow. Right, like that at high school, you can't teach that. He's that special of a kid. So
it's like act like you've been there.
That's right, and he sure does.
Yeah, that's kind of cool.
How does it feel coaching your alma mater?
Awesome. Yeah, it's awesome.
Gotta be neat.
Truly special. I wouldn't coach anywhere else in the state, quite honestly.
Wow.
It's a very good feeling, especially to represent the alumni base, obviously the kids in the classroom. And
do a great job.
Thank you.
No doubt about it.
What do you think now with the recruiting? I mean, how's it? I mean, I was head coach at Sun Valley, my old alma mater, but these guys, assistants, so you could see it's tough winning. But
used to say if we could have a wing-eating contest, we would have did really good.
That's right.
Just wasn't the case.
There you go. Yeah.
But I know now they with the portal and the NIL and everything, it seems like instead of recruiting high school seniors, they're losing out because they're looking for transfers. And do you see that, or are they Absolutely. Still coming into the high schools? And
so the transfer portal has killed high school recruiting. Yeah. It's a shame, but it's just the facts. And the one thing I tell everybody, like especially parents, is you have to have nowadays realistic expectations. So I was sharing with one of you guys.
Yeah, you said it.
My senior year, for example, I got recruited to Duke and went and played Duke for a year. Today I would have been CAA level because of these Power 5 schools, they're only hitting the portal. And it's a shame because it's tearing locker rooms apart.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's no sense of, you know, creating a culture, have 18-year-olds every year that you have to kind of mold and the seniors watch. It's just, you look at like what Deion Sanders is doing. He brings in 55 guys from the portal.
All right. Portal, yeah.
It's like, yeah, you're going to be good on paper, but do you really create a culture? So it's hurt. It's hindered high school football recruiting for sure.
Do you think some of these, like Nick Saban just retired, do you think a lot of these great coaches are like, you know, basketball specialists?
It happened to Jay Wright. Jay Wright at Nova said, I don't want to deal with the NIL anymore.
Yep.
I don't blame him. I mean, it's hard enough to recruit a 17-year-old to go into a dining room and try to schmooze over the mother to try to get the kid here, let alone now you have to answer to an 18-year-old kid, do you have $7 million for me? Like, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous.
And the scholarships, they don't even mean anything anymore. We got scholarships.
No.
It was
you know, it was a big deal. Now it's nothing. I mean, they're getting. I mean, Caleb Williams, the quarterback for USC, he says if the first pick the Bears draft him, he wants part of the ownership of the team.
Yeah.
Because he's making the $3-4 million now, doing his commercials and everything. Which yeah. I don't. I think if you're going to get paid that kind of money, jump on it. But the Power Five, I think. I don't know what you think. Is going to pretty much. That's going to be all of NCAA football. It's going to kill the smaller schools, the Temples and the smaller Division One schools.
Yeah, I mean, I think players should be compensated for their name, image, and likeness. I mean, the NCAA is a $1 billion industry.
Yeah.
So a guy throwing 5 touchdowns a week for USC, like. He should get compensating. I'm all for that. But it's like to use that in recruiting where they have their hand out to see who can pay them more, that gets a little dicey, I think. To your point, yes, like it's tough for the middle market team, but they're going to the portal. Right. So it's like, yes, it's hard to win that top, hard to win, but these guys, there's 2,000 players right now in the portal.
That's a scary thing, too. We were talking about, me and Joe, you have starters leaving.
Yeah,
it's like, you know, you're not just
free agency.
About, yeah. You know, it's just like this. Well, he's starting at this team. There's a better opportunity here.
It's become semi-pro.
Yeah.
And you won't see any legacy anymore. You won't see guys that, you know, you'd see a Notre Dame guy. You know, Notre Dame quarterback was from Wake Forest. And again, another guy this year from
Duke.
That's right.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I don't know the family legacy. You play where your father played and stuff like that. You're not going to see that anymore with this revolving door of kids. It's a shame, really.
Yeah, you wonder if like they're going to regulate it at some point, but you know, it's the world we live in now. Yeah. So you either have to adapt to it or you die. Right. You know, I mean, it's just as simple as that.
No team unity either. It's like, it's not tough. Working, yeah. You know, football, you can get hurt, you know, second string going right now, but there's no unity. Your starting quarterback's gone.
Yeah.
Just to make money.
It's tough. Yeah.
It is. It's hard.
And then how do you adjust as coach in high school now? I mean, we used to do Oklahoma drill and stuff. How's the coaching changed from when you played to now being a coach with the less hitting in practice and
yeah.
And I know summer heat restrictions and stuff like that.
Absolutely.
How have you adjusted to that?
So I'm big on hitting but staying up. I find going down to the ground overrated because when you go down to the ground, injuries happen. Well, that's when the ACLs occur. That's when the ankles get the linemen get rolled up on. You see that on TV all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's obviously guidelines that we abide by and we have to. I am much more focused on making sure the kids are healthy week 10 than they are week 1. And if we're able to teach wrapping up and the proper way to tackle and do that by falling on a pad, that saves the kids back as opposed to going down to the ground. So I'm all for hitting. And Tuesdays and Wednesdays we hit, we put the helmet on, we're in full gear. And that obviously leads to competition.
Right.
But I think you have to be very smart about it. And we try to. I think we were, you know, you ask our staff in the past, this is the healthiest, knock on wood, that our team's ever been. And it showed in week 13, obviously, in the state title.
So. You're doing it in the off season, so you're getting a lot of work done in the off season, I guess.
Yeah, we're extremely blessed. Like Damian McGovern, we have a full-time strength coach at Salesianum.
Oh, dear.
So that goes to show you, like, what the administration thinks about you know, the enhancing the student athlete. So we have a full-time strength coach. So these kids in the off season, they'll report to Damian 2-3 times a week for all the sports, not just football. It's a huge resource for us.
Anyone beat Carl Bond, who's in the audience? His bench record, what was it, 485?
Carl still looks like he could play. so yeah.
I walked up to him. I was like, "Congratulations on the big win." He was like, "What?
Yeah, yeah. He still looks like he could play." But no, we don't touch 45.
No way.
I think Carl holds the Maryland record.
He does.
Still.
That's right.
Somebody broke that. You beat Pete Koss's record.
Yeah,
that's pretty impressive. Pretty impressive.
He'll be up soon.
So I guess the last question, Eagles, thoughts? What's your prediction for this weekend?
For a measly high school coach to comment on the NFL, it's tough to do. I think they'll beat the Buccaneers. I got to be honest, I'm not a huge Eagles fan.
You're not a Cowboys fan.
I'm not
a Cowboys
fan.
Packers, right?
I grew up cheering for the Giants, believe it or not. My dad went to Columbia and then lived in the Bronx for 4 or 5 years. So But they have their work cut out for it. I like watching the Ravens because I think Lamar Jackson's the best football player in football. Player in the NFL.
I think that's the best team this year.
I do too. I mean, Niners, I think the Shanahan's the best offensive play caller in the NFL, hands down.
Being a Paisan, what did you think of Vinny Cutlets from the Giants?
I was pulling for him. Then they yanked the carpet out from underneath him. I was all for him.
He had his 2 minutes of fame.
That's right. That's right. My daughter and I were doing the whole gabagool.
A couple questions, anybody in the audience? For Gene?
NFL contracts and stuff like that. So we talked a lot about the NIL. So is it going to be now that an 18-year-old, 17-year-old will have to sign a contract? Because why should a Penn State, Michigan State, or whomever take this kid if they're going to go into the portal? Like, is that the next step because of all this NIL?
It could be. It's a great question. Oddly enough, NIL's here now in high school. And Delaware's one of, I might butcher this, but 6 or 7 states that don't have it yet, but the rest of the country does. So a good friend of mine, John Noonan, real quick, he has 2 stud point guards at Ursuline. They've already gotten confronted to come to Pennsylvania for NIL money. They're freshmen.
Wow.
So it's a great way to rate. High school.
High school freshmen?
High school. High school freshmen. Come across. I'd be afraid to mention it, but there's a couple. Like, those boarding schools, they have dollars. So NIL is already here in high school. So it comes up every day, and Taylor and I talk about it all the time. Like, when will the meeting at Salesianum occur? Because it's going to come, and hopefully our sports programs, I mean, lacrosse is already second in the country, soccer's 5th or whatever they've been. It's inevitable. It's coming. So what do? You just say no, and then you don't. But you're also not going to get the talent. You're not going to be on the regional map that Salesianum wants.
Right?
I mean, that conversation's coming.
It really is hard.
But it does. To execute a contract, that's a great idea. Yeah, you would think so, maybe.
Is there any other questions for Coach?
Coach, this year you had an event the morning of Thanksgiving to bring alumni.
Yes.
Field. Thought it was great.
Thank you.
I appreciate you came over and talked to my dad, who's a much older alumnus, and it was great. What have you done in your first year from a tradition standpoint, either changed or kept the same from your football days?
So, great question. Maintaining the pride and tradition that Mr. Kevin Reilly mentioned, it was first and foremost in paramount that I wanted to do. From day one, I think having played at Salesianum and graduated, I understood that pretty well. So that was the first thing. I wasn't there to go rogue and say we're going to be this modern day type Colorado program and forget what's happened in the past. So things like maintaining the Thanksgiving tradition that I believe Coach DiNardo did was something that we maintained. The gold helmet. I mean, there's been conversations like, do we put helmet stickers on the helmet? I was like, no. Nobody touches that gold helmet. You know, things like that. I mentioned that at the same time, you also have to evolve the program and the culture because these kids nowadays are smart and they all have these things and they're all on social media and they all want to come to the coolest program. It is what it is. None of them know what Salesianum football was like in 1970, right? But they know that they wear Nike. Yeah. So there's like that push and pull that you have to do, but maintaining and then also involving the alumni. That has to be done at Salesianum. And if you're not, you're missing the boat. What's up? We do. Yeah, we do. We have each captain leads us in. So this year it was 5. It was Our Father. We started with the Our Father, 3 Hail Marys and the Glory Be at the end. We still do the pregame mass. Father Beretta, our principal, led that. That tradition will never end. So still do those kind of things that obviously has stuck from the past.
That's great.
All right. So, Gene, like, we appreciate you for coming tonight.
Thank you, guys.
And we are really looking forward to the 2024 season of Salesianum football.
Appreciate you having me, guys.
Thank you. That was another great guest. Hey, let's give a shout-out time to the great staff here tonight at Finnegans Pub 302, especially our bartenders, Tyler and Alexa, serving all the drinks.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please don't forget to take care of your bartenders. And I'll give someone a 20 if they take Tim out of here. Thank you.
Okay, so now it's time for our next special guest, and that is Salesianum head basketball coach, Taylor Trevisan. Taylor is a 09 graduate of Salesianum High School. He continued his basketball career on Hawk Hill before finishing it at Chestnut Hill College, where in his graduate season he was MVP, leading the Griffins in scoring and rebounding. Taylor was named the 19th head coach of Salesianum's basketball program in 2018. Welcome, Taylor, to the Pos 5.
This is pretty exciting. It's an honor and tough act to follow with Gene and Kevin Reilly, but I'll do my best.
You'll be great.
Yeah, sure you will.
Hey, last season you won the state title in a heart stopper, 48-44 over William Penn. Heading into a new season, what are your expectations?
To do it again.
Of course.
But before that, and you know, we share this with the team, we play one of the hardest schedules you can put together for a high school team in this area. We play a lot of Philly Catholic League schools. We play a lot of schools from the DMV area. And, you know, we did that by design when I took over to try to, you know, he mentioned, Coach Deldon mentioned our lacrosse team and our soccer team and the success they've had and the level they're at. And when I took over, me and the staff, our goal was to get to that level that they're at. And part of that is scheduling games in the not just the local area, but regionally. And we've been doing that the last 4 years. And we've always competed in these games against these Philly Catholic schools, the Newman Gorettis, the Imhoteps, you know, all these schools. And to my team before the year, I said, well, I want to start winning these games, not just competing in them before we get to the back-to-back state championship thing. So, you know, we've hit our lumps against some of these teams early in the year. We just got a big win against Malvern on last Saturday before a tough one against St. E's locally. But our goal is to win some of these regional games that we're scheduling and then you know, come back and win the state championship again.
Beautiful. So, Tally, obviously, you just touched on it. And just like football, obviously, Salesianum basketball does play a tougher schedule than the majority of the teams in the state of Delaware.
Than anybody.
Anybody. So we'll change that up. Yeah, we'll say than anybody. So do you prepare any different for those games? And it's actually a two-question thing here for you. And then what are your thoughts on playing that tougher schedule?
I don't think we prepare any differently. I mean, we prepare the same no matter who it is. We have our processes as coaches and the coaching staff on, you know, our film and our scouting report and our pregame practices leading up to these games. So the approach doesn't necessarily change. What was the second part of that question?
What are your thoughts on playing a tougher schedule?
You know, Coach Seldon talked about running a modern program. And to me, you have to schedule those type of games. You want to attract the best talent, which we want to do. Kids are looking for exposure to get those very coveted scholarships that you're talking about. And if you're not giving them the opportunities on big stages to get noticed, they might go to Philly. You look at any Philly Catholic League school's roster, there's a couple of Delaware kids on it.
Yeah.
And why are they there? Because it's a Philly Catholic League school, and they're going to get a lot of exposure, and they're going to get a lot of college coaches come look at them. So our goal is to keep those kids at home and play a schedule that they're going to get the exposure they want. On top of just challenging our program and trying to lift our program up to another level, you know, I love and as a competitor, why don't you want to play the best? You know what I mean?
Awesome.
I mean, like,
yeah, great, yeah, great I agree. With
you can look
that.
At some of these, you know, schedules of these local teams, and their records are great. And scheduling this has actually hurt us in the past with seeding in our playoffs. And coaches will in the area will look at that and say, "Well, I'm not going to do that if it's going to hurt our chances." But to me, it helps the program elevate. It helps attract kids that you want to the program, and it helps put, you know, Sally's on the map in different areas and try to elevate the program and the school.
All right.
Is there any you know, the biggest thing, though, too, is there's no letdown weeks. How do you keep them up? You know what I mean? You're playing the best every week in, week out. I mean, how do you do that as a coach?
It is difficult. we're still trying to figure that out, I think. Sure. You know, and we're going to get, you know, for every Delaware school, you know, when I say we're playing the best out-of-state schedule, that's not disrespecting any Delaware schools because we get the best shot of any Delaware school. I mean, it's other Delaware schools' Super Bowl. You know, St. E's, they're a very good team, very talented, and beating us is, you know, they don't win a state championship, they'll go home and be like, my senior year, we beat Salesianum. Yeah, so we get everybody's best shot, and it's more of a mentality to the kids. Like, this is what you want. Like, not just for sport, but in life. Like, you want to challenge yourself. You want to go against the best. You want to – who wants a letdown week? What fun is that? You know, what fun is beating up on whoever? I mean, it's just – to me, that's never been my mentality. But it is tough to get these kids. You know, their mind is a little different, and trying to get them to realize the opportunities and the challenge and that it's part of the fun. Like, we've been talking about having fun lately at our meetings and practices. It's tough having fun when you're losing at times, but the process of trying to figure it out is the fun part if you, like, really want to buy into it. So
you got some key returners coming back, 6'5", 6'6", and 6'7". This, obviously, the size helps you. How talented are they in the group that you have returning?
This is a dangerous thing to say on such a popular program, but I have told people in private that this is the most talented basketball team Salesianum has ever seen.
Wow.
That's not any disrespect to any, older teams, but talent-wise, I don't think we've had more talent. Now, with that being said, with talent comes a lot of challenges and egos and, they're high school kids, but just getting them in the right frame of mind consistently is very tough. But our returning crew, I think, is one of the best teams talent-wise that Salesianum has ever seen. And I've told the guys that. I said, this is like a challenge. We don't want to shy away from that. We want to embrace that and use that, not make it put pressure on ourselves. So our returning guys, I mean, from Kareem Thomas, who he's committed to Dartmouth, Ivy League, four-year education, you know, playing Division I basketball. We have two more guys that will probably end up Division I, hopefully. So three guys, you know, who could be Division I, and then a couple more who could even sniff that are younger guys in a couple of years. So I think we're a really deep team, and to have this many guys coming back from a state championship team is pretty rare. So
that's great.
Yeah.
What do you think about the changes in the game? I mean, the three-point shot, there's nobody in the paint anymore. I haven't seen you guys play, but yeah, it's a way different game than – We played it 30 years ago.
Yeah. You know, we don't have a traditional back-to-the-basket big, and, you know, if we're going to talk Sixers at any point, you know, I know people like to yell, you know, put Joel down on the block.
Come on, yeah.
Like, yes, at times that is what you should do, but I think, a guy like that, you're limiting his ability. Like, if you're only going to say go sit on the block, like, he can do so many other things. Why wouldn't you try to utilize those things? Now, again, at times it's frustrating because you're like, you're bigger, you're stronger. Just go beat that guy up. Now, at the high school level, you know, positionless basketball is a term that you hear a lot. Like, guys are interchangeable, and you know, we play a similar style. Funny that you mentioned that, though. Like, we beat Malvern. Like, we dominated them on the inside. Now, dominating them on the inside doesn't mean putting someone on the block and doing that. It means just getting paint touches. We talk about paint touches all the time. Like, get paint touches. Right, get on the offensive glass and beat someone up on there. So, you know, it's definitely a faster game. Again, not as slow and traditional bigs, but, you know, just like Gene said, there's way to – I always say, like, you can change things all you want, right? And basketball has changed, but you kind of dress it differently. So when I say that, I mean, like, instead of having the guy who you sit on the block and say, go beat this guy up, like – you say, all right, we're going to start five out, all right? And you have your biggest guy on the perimeter. And then you run a set, and there's some motion, and there's an action, and the next thing you know, he's on the block, and he's beating someone up.
Yeah.
And it's just like you're doing the same thing. It just looks a little different. And the kids think it looks a little different. And the kids buy into it because you're not limiting them by just, you know, telling them to do one thing and one thing only. So as much as it changes, it is the same. And to the football point, like, Michigan just won a national title by pounding the ball down people's throats, right?
Yeah.
So,
so true.
You know, things change, but at the same time, they're the same, you know?
That's interesting.
Yeah.
So you have Kareem Thompson and Isaiah Hinson?
Isaiah Hinson. Yeah. Yep. Justin Hines, another one who's really, really good.
You get you considering them the backbone of the team this year?
Yeah, for sure. Those three specifically, just being returning seniors, you know, supposed to be our best players. Just kind of raising their – it's, you know, it's been a challenge. You win as a junior and you come back and you just – as high school kids, you think you can just kind of show up. And so trying to challenge those guys to be leaders, one, to raise their expectations and their standards and trying to continue to get better, is it's a challenge getting a high school kid to do that. But those three kids are good kids, and, you know, there's always ups and downs of a season, but ultimately those three guys, plus everyone else, they come back and they're showing up the next day and trying to figure things out and try to get better.
So. Well, let me ask you this. That's the thing. Now you're marked. You know, you're the guys to beat. What changes your style of coaching? What has changed with the way you're presenting it, and also, you know, how did you come into this year? Like you said, you just can't show up and win it.
Yeah. You know, I think – you know, we talk about this as coaches, high school especially. You know, college, you can recruit the guys you want to run the system you want. High school, like, yeah, you want certain kids to come to your program, and you maybe talk to them and try to get them to come. But ultimately, you have to change your style year to year.
So it does change.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And even this year, with as many returners as we have coming back, we changed our style to play faster than we have before. Because we have so many guys that can do so many things, it's like, how do we maximize everybody? And to us, it's like, we have to get more shots. We have to play up and down so that, you know, those three guys specifically, we've told them all, like, we want you to shoot 15 shots a game, like, each, on top of the other guys that are playing. So in order to do that, we need to go up and down more than we have in the past. So our offseason emphasized transition, offense, secondary transition, and, you know, some people in the stands might look at it and go, man, they're taking some quick, like, not great shots. But sometimes they might, but sometimes you got to live with some of those things to try to let these guys play and you know, not force them into doing one thing and one thing only. So
How's the weight room played with basketball now?
Yeah, no, it's definitely, I don't want to say not important. It's definitely important, but it's not, you know, to the degree of football necessarily. You know, a lot of basketball training, you know, is with flexibility and agility and explosiveness more so than, like, setting weight records and bench records. You know, we do a lot of mobility days with Coach McGovern, who's the full-time strength and conditioning coach, where he's just putting guys through different stretches, you know, core work, weightlift stuff. And, you know, we even do yoga. Our schedule, we just played 3 games in 4 days down in the beach over break, and we were going to play 3 games in 4 days before the weather yesterday. So sometimes you just got to keep them loose and fresh. They're high school kids, yes, but their bodies, you know, they still need time to recover and stretch and be flexible. So it's important, but a little different than other sports.
That's interesting, because we did that, me and Joe, when we were playing at Temple. We did karate for the stretching. So you see the stretching, and Mike and Mark did the sumo training.
Yeah, nice. That worked out really well. Mr. Kegelman back in the day?
Yes.
So he's a yoga instructor now. I don't know if you knew that. In retirement. So he comes in and he works with our team, Mr. Kegelman, and does yoga with our basketball team.
Wait a second. Mr. Kegelman's a yoga teacher?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Good for him.
How was it playing in the Big Five? I saw you were the most improved player. I don't know what year that was you were there. That's really impressive. But how'd you like playing against Temple, Villanova?
People ask me all the time. So I don't know how much the story was told, but I was originally a walk-on at St. Joe's, turned scholarship player my senior year. And people ask me, like, would you, you know, especially kids, would you have rather gone and played D2 or D3 and played more? I'm like, absolutely not. Like, I love the experience and how much I learned. Phil Martelli, I was just telling some coaches, we have gone through some struggles of late, and I texted him at like 2 a.m. Wow. Like, Coach, like, I know you're busy. He's now the associate head coach of Michigan.
Yeah.
I said, Coach, I know you're busy. You don't have to get back to me today. You don't have to get back to me tomorrow, next week, or next month. Just like, here's what I'm thinking. Like, I'd love to get your thoughts. This is at 2 a.m. He calls me at 7:30 a.m. the next day. So to, like, answer your question, it's amazing to be part of, like, a guy like Phil Martelli's history. At that time, Fran Dunphy was coaching at Temple. The A-10 in general, outside of the Big Five, you had Jay Wright. You had Giannini at LaSalle. You had Shaka Smart at VCU, who was in the A-10. you had some like incredible coaches in the A-10 that I was just kind of soaking everything up as a walk-on guy who wasn't performing every night. So it was an honor to be a part of. I wouldn't change it for the world, and I've taken so much from that and in the relationships.
You kicked ass at Chestnut Hill though when you graduated.
We did pretty good at Chestnut Hill, and it was nice to like get to play and play college basketball at Division II level at Chestnut Hill. Started and played and got that experience as well. So I think I got best of both worlds.
Good for you.
Yeah. All right, we got to have it. Who's your Eagles pick?
I think so. I was just talking about this with a couple guys. You know, listening to sports talk radio all day and just guys beating up on the Eagles. And like at this point, you're a fan, like root for them. And I have full faith, and I would bet on them that they are going to win on Monday.
Wow.
I'm going to say by two scores.
There we go.
Only thing that worries me, my old teammates, Todd Bowles, the head coach of Tampa Bay.
Wow. And,
He's a great defensive coach.
He is.
So they're going to have a blitzing scheme that if they don't pick up the blitzers, Hurts is going to get beat up, and I'm a huge Eagles fan. So
I don't know if you saw what Chad Ochocinco said.
What did he say?
But he said that the Eagles have been playing possum. He said, wait till the playoffs. They've just been playing hurt, right. And they're going to have answers to all these, the blitzing,
that'd
and all
be
these,
awesome.
These issues. So I'm a fan of his, and I'm rolling with that.
Nice. So we got a little time here. Does anybody have a coach or a quote coach? Anybody have a question for coach? Any basketball questions? I know there's some old Sally's basketball guys
there's
from
Mike. Sally's great. Tim
Morris.
Yeah,
Sally's great.
Dude, let me give Tim a little prop. Tim Morris, the 87, was a stud.
Oh, I love it.
And also a great player, Widener.
Of course.
So I want to reference something Gene said about high school programs being much more like college. And I think Mike, great true sport athlete. I know even like Brian O'Neill. Gene, you were. Like, is it even possible now for elite athletes to like be a great football player and then play basketball? Yeah. How likely or unlikely is that? So
I think it is becoming more difficult, but like it can be done. And if you're that good of an athlete to be able to play, like you're able to do it. Now it takes a special athlete and a special kid to make that commitment. I will also say there has to be coaches. You have to have communication between sports. Like me and Coach Deladon, even me and Coach DiNardo, we had, and Coach Mosier with the soccer team, because I have some soccer guys. As long as everyone's on the same page sport-wise or coaching-wise, it can be done. Now, it is hard, and it takes a lot from the kid, and the coaches have to be willing to, Coach Deladon was asking me, hey, can Brady McBride come to throw tomorrow morning? Like, checking in with me, do you guys have practice? Is it okay if he throws? And that's great. And if it wasn't, and I told him, I really need him tomorrow morning, we have a game and whatever, he'd be completely understanding of that. So it takes some coordination from not just the kid who obviously hopefully has the commitment, but the coaches and the parents to make it happen. Again, it's definitely more difficult, but it definitely can be done, if done the right way.
Yeah, I always thought the multi-sport athlete was your best player most of the time.
Yeah, I mean, you look at any pro sport player, there's quotes and stories out there of them. Me playing multiple sports helped me get to where I was, for sure.
Yeah, my brother Chris, when he played basketball, he actually never dressed, so he used to wear his street clothes under his sweatsuit.
I would always look for that quick exit.
When I was at St. Joe's, sometimes I had to make sure I had my jersey on, because I was never usually getting in. But and it was funny, during games there would be fans behind us, and they'd be going to the snack bar and stuff, and they would ask me you want anything? It'd be the same people sitting. So the first time it happened, I was no, I don't want anything. And then it's the same people sitting behind me, so I was yeah, grab me some popcorn. And so as I was my junior senior year, they would have my order, and they'd sit it right behind my seat on the bench, and I'd be snacking. So
I saw you make that three pointer. I was he has nacho sauce on his face. I wanted to say one thing. You know what? The future of Salesianum is golden with these two guys coaching at the helm.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about it. Yeah. I mean, these guys are two winners.
Great job.
And it's a pleasure to meet both of you.
Trev, thanks so much, man.
Real pleasure.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Fun. Appreciate it.
Sally's has two smooth head coaches. I mean, he's got that's like Collins coaches talking.
Very impressive.
Players are very lucky to have you guys.
I love it though too. The biggest thing that these both guys have, you just keep evolving. Is that what am I saying that right? But you know, it's not like they win state championships. You think you could sit on your laurels, and they're only getting better. They're changing their style. I mean, Sally's is what a future.
Well, we just want to thank everyone so much for coming out tonight. We really appreciate it.
Could I say one thing? Tyler, the bartender, have you guys seen online? Where we live, there was a police chase, and a guy was delivering a pizza. That's the guy who kicked the ass of the guy, the criminal.
Tyler, the bartender.
He's the one that tripped up the guy stealing the car.
The car thief, yes.
There he is.
Quick, though, too, I went into the house afterwards, and the family was like, look, the pizza was in perfect shape. Good job, Tyler.
Wait a second.
He was like this, kicking the guy's ass, holding the pizza up. Our last guest is the guy he tripped. Come on out.
Run, Tyler.
So, right. Tim Gallagher, that message was for you. That's the guy that trips people up. We want to thank you so much to our special guest, Kevin Reilly, Gene Della Don, the great football coach from Salesianum, Taylor. Now, am I getting this? Trevisan?
Trevisan.
I said it wrong earlier, and great I apologize, coach. Great basketball coach for Salesianum. I think Chris was saying earlier, the future is bright. You are a Salesianum sports fan, that's for sure. Our host, Paul. Paul, thank you so much.
Paul.
And I have to say, here at Finnegans Pub 302, just a beautiful place. Well, it's the first time I've been here, and I'll certainly be back. It's a welcoming place and a beautiful place, and thank you for having us. Of course, we mentioned Tyler, the great bartender, and his cohort back there, Alexa. Thank you so much. Our sponsors. We have some terrific sponsors here at the Paz 5. One of the leading sponsors, the Segarra Brothers. They are the owners of Shaving Grace. Shaving Grace is an excellent salon for men. They do a full blade shave if you're into the hot towel and all that. So they have locations in Exton, Malvern, and East Falls.
And it's three brothers.
Yeah,
that's great the guys. Key. Great I mean, guys. You know, the family type thing. This was really like a family show tonight with some great guests. So
they do beard. Like for me, they'll do around the beard. For Mike, they do his whole head.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Yeah,
fantastic.
Like me and Paul meet every week.
Last, I just say, please follow us on our Facebook page. That's at the Paz 5 or on the web, thepaz5.com. Thank you so much for coming out, folks.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hey, everyone. If you enjoyed our show today, don't keep it to yourself. Tell your family, tell your friends, tell the world. Follow, and share. And if you didn't get enough, make sure to follow The Paz 5 on Facebook and check out our website, thepaz5.com. We'll be back with more fun next week. But I know I'm going to change that tune. When I'm back on top, back on top.